Subscribe to our YouTube channel for in-depth interviews of India Inc. and press the bell icon so that you do not miss our updates.
Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Nirmal Bang. I am Hiral Dadia. We have with us Mr. Anand Narayan, Professor of Finance, SPGMR. Thank you for joining us, Anand. It's a pleasure having you on the show. We are in unprecedented times, and I think enough has been spoken as to what has been the impact so far with regards to COVID-19 on the economy versus, you know, the different economies across as well. But if I have to take your assessment as to how bad the impact is on India versus the other economies, what would your, you know, judgment be on that?
Morning, Hiral, and thanks for having me. Pleasure to be here with you and the Nirmal Banking. Look, I guess, yes, this is unprecedented, and this is an adjective which has been used quite a bit nowadays. And you're right, every part of the world has been impacted. In fact, just for as a matter of perspective, in 2008, when we saw the global financial crisis, the global growth, degrowth, was just 0.1% of GDP for the whole year, right? This year, IMF estimates that the entire world will see a degrowth of minus 4.9%. That just tells you the scale of the problem vis-a-vis the global financial crisis, and it's a global problem. Now, unfortunately, for emerging markets and particularly for India, the impact is even far more greater than the rest of the world, the average rest of the world. And that's for a couple of reasons. One is, of course, that our economy entered into this crisis already on a weak note. We were not really on a strong footing as we entered. And the second problem, of course, is that we did have a very intense lockdown, arguably one of the most stringent lockdowns that we've seen anywhere in the world. And to that extent, large parts of the economy were shut down during the last 4 months. And that obviously will have a debilitating impact on the economy as a whole. What will the impact look like, Hiral? Everybody is guessing right now. Frankly, numbers have become Excel spreadsheets, and you know, we're all trying to do estimates there. So we don't really have accurate estimates or reliable estimates as such. Even in good times, we don't have. In times like this, it's completely missing. But at least the scenarios I'm running indicate a pretty poor picture. For one, the GDP growth in this fiscal year, FY21, could be contraction by a double digit. I think it's beyond 10% contraction. Second, it does look like many, many businesses will be hit hard. At least some of the research I'm looking at indicates 20-25% of all micro, small, medium enterprises could face a real existential crisis. The non-performing assets of banks and financial institutions, therefore, could go up to really high levels. The RBI puts an extreme case of 14.7% of advances. I think it could be even worse than that, to be honest. Likewise, finally, the fiscal deficit and the could actually go up to over 14% of GDP across center and state. And a lot of the fiscal deficit will have to be monetized by the RBI. So all put together, it doesn't look good at all, but here is the good news. There are ways out. You know, beyond the point, what we've gone through, that's not as important as how we come out of it. If we do the right things right now, there is still light at the end of the tunnel. So it's not all gloom and doom, even though the prognosis doesn't look great.
Right. So Anand, is it right to say that the worst is behind us right now, but the recovery is unlikely to be smooth? Is that a fair statement to be made right now?
I guess you could say that, Hira. Let me expand on what you're saying. Clearly, this crisis starts off as a medical crisis. So when you say is the worst behind us, the first question to ask is the worst behind us for the medical crisis? I.e., are we sure we don't have to do a lockdown again? That we don't have to go through what we went through the last 4 months? Now, if you see the headline numbers, they don't look good at all. You know, we had a record number of daily cases yesterday, over 55,000 cases. Deaths are going as well, and the geographical spread is increasing as well. But I do see some silver linings here. So a couple of things. One is that, of course, our testing rates have gone up dramatically. we're now testing almost 5 lakh per day, which is great. And the numbers are going up every day, which is good. The second part is, you know, the result which came out of that TIFR survey, which indicates that in places like Dharavi, where there is plateauing happening of number of cases, there seems to be a lot of, antibody serum being developed already, which means a lot of people have got the disease and have come out with asymptomatic cases and already have antibodies built in them. Now, that's fantastic news. In fact, the number, if I remember, was 57.8% for some of the slums around Matunga Chembur. Now, that's an incredibly high number. Even Sweden has not managed that. So what it seems to indicate is that a lot of the disease has already gone through, the pandemic has gone through, and there is a lot of resistance already built in, a herd immunity already being built in, at least in some pockets, which means that while we might see a geographical spread going out, hopefully in 2-3 months time, we will see plateauing everywhere, including in the places like Pune and Kala, where we're seeing a high number of cases. And lastly, of course, the medical response from the authorities has improved. So the number of beds available, ICUs and ventilators, that seems to be good as well. So all in all, I do think there are silver linings in this very, very sordid COVID-19 story from a medical perspective. On the health, on the economic perspective, I think you're right. Hopefully, we don't see any more lockdowns therefore. In 2-3 months time, maybe we can aspire to come back to normalcy, some kind of normalcy. But absolutely right. It will be a torturous, you know, recovery path. A lot of good things have to happen for us to get back to anywhere near our immense economic potential. A lot of good things have to be undertaken now. So it's not an easy path at all.
Right. And Anand, with this, what's happening is, you know, when you talk to industries, when you talk to businesses, the indication that we're getting right now is that spends are higher in rural areas. Recovery is faster in rural areas versus what's happening in the urban areas. If we have to take that scenario into consideration, do you think the rural resilience is something which is going to be sustainable? Because the indicators of rural activity have continued to suggest that relative resilience right now, at least from the macro data.
I think it sustains. So here is the reality. In June, we did see a good spike up in rural spending. For instance, tractor sales, even autos and two-wheelers in the rural areas, the sales were looking good. And of course, FMCG products were selling well as well in rural areas. In July, there has been a plateauing again. So, you know, the question is being asked as to, because the COVID-19 spread is now going into rural areas as well, is that rural economy facing a bit of a challenge? I don't think so. I think the in general, there will be a relative advantage for rural areas vis-a-vis urban areas for a few reasons. By the way, by way of context, India has very funny ways of defining rural versus urban. Okay? So urban rural areas are anything with density less than 400 people per square kilometer. And by that token, 65% of India stays in rural areas. And that accounts for 45% of India's GDP, very broadly. That's the number to remember. Okay. Now, the reason why I think this rural relative positivity will sustain is the following. This COVID-19 remains relatively low. Social distancing is a lot more easier in less congested rural areas, right? So that's the first point. Second, a lot of the government impetus on actually giving relief has reached rural areas. I think the governments have done a great job on NREGA, on the Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. It's already 40,000 crores plus has been sanctioned and given out in those rural areas, which is great. Third, you know, the Food Corporation of India has done a huge amount of procuring of food grains, which puts money into the hands of farmers. Plus, it gives food security, which is why the Prime Minister could announce till November, everybody gets, you know, free food grains and so on and so forth. By the way, FCI is sitting on record levels of food grains today compared to any time in the past, right? Fourth, the monsoons are looking still okay. While the last week has been a little disappointing, overall, the geographical spread is looking good. We are still looking at agriculture, which is about 15% of our GDP, growing by maybe 3-4% this year compared to last year. So all this put together looks like the rural support will sustain. It will not make up for all the hardship we are seeing in the urban areas, which is where, unfortunately, COVID-19 is a problem as well. But it should sustain. So I think the sectors which are delivering to the rural sector will do reasonably well. And the rural economy itself will hopefully support us going forward to some extent. But there's still a lot to be done. It's not enough giving relief to the rural sector. And to your earlier point, for a recovery, a lot more needs to be done.
Right. So with this, with agriculture, if you talk about the manufacturing sector as well, again, if you see the data that did come in the month of June, the manufacturing PMI, that was almost around 47.2 in the month of June, as against a 30.8 in the previous month. Similarly, if you see manufacturing, which is measured by IP, that declined by almost around 39% on a year-on-year basis. With this, the services activity has constantly remained mixed. So what do you make out of these data points that are coming in for the manufacturing and the service industry? Because a lot is dependent on these two as well from the employment perspective.
Oh, absolutely. No questions asked. In fact, on the day when the lockdown started, on 25th of March, my estimate is that only 36% of the economy was operating. So you had agriculture operating, you had, public, administration, all the government offices operating, you had financial services operating, you had healthcare and a few other services operating. Mm-hmm. Bulk of industry and services shut down. So there's been a slow recovery since then as the lockdowns opened up, and now we're in unlock 3 or whatever it is. So it's been slowly opening up. But a significant chunk of industry and services are still closed. They're the obvious ones. Tourism, travel, any kind of discretionary spending clearly is down in a big way. In fact, Hiral, the way I would put it is the following. If 36% of the economy was operating on 25th of March, as of now, it looks like between 80 to 85% of the economy is operating. We are still not even come to 100% of the economy operating. And by the way, 80 to 85 is probably a generous number. So you're absolutely right. Industry and services are still hit in a bad way. Of course, certain parts of industry and services are hit worse than the others. Things like largely MSMEs, largely discretionary spending, tourism, travel, even areas such as commercial vehicles, construction and real estate, all of them are taking a big hit. And it will take some while before we hit 100% here. It's not going to happen in our
region. Right. So Anand, with this now, if you have to look at the revival plan from here on, what should the roadmap look like? Because what's happening is you already have a stimulus package that was announced by the government so far. Now, yes, you cannot expect the government to come in and support all sectors in all possible ways. I mean, there will be selections as on the basis of importance that will be made. But from here on, if the government has to take another step with regards to, say, a stimulus package, what should the roadmap look like? Because initial one has more weight of a credit, stimulus versus a fiscal stimulus, as we all know about it. What should it look like according to you?
Great question, Hiral. And I think both have to go together. You need to have a short-term relief roadmap, and relief is not enough. There is more relief which is required very clearly. But the extent to which you can give relief also depends upon you having a credible medium to long-term plan in front of you. You need both to go hand in hand. You're right, the capacity for the government to give a lot of relief might be limited. But if you have a credible medium-term plan in place, your capacity to give relief right now will go up. So on the immediate relief part, I think the government is doing a good job as far as I mentioned, rural employment is concerned, as far as giving food security is concerned, as far as giving money to everybody in, with having a Jan Dhan Yojana account and, to women, to the Divyangs and so on and so forth. So that's a good job. I would argue for two things which needs to be done. One is for urban unemployed. While we have rural employment, urban population also requires some kind of support systems. Along with that, you need to get back workers from the rural areas. You need to provide them with some kind of safe residential, public services so that they can come back and not worry about health and food and so on and so forth. So that part is required. Second, much bigger on the business side. As you rightly mentioned, yes, there's been a 3 lakh crore credit guarantee scheme, etc. But that is providing liquidity to corporates rather than providing relief in terms of bottom line. A lot of these micro, small, medium enterprises have problems on top line and bottom line. Giving them loans doesn't really help, right? And that's where I think some kind of relief is required. We've been kind of very parsimonious and stingy in giving that relief. I'm hoping that as the unlock goes on and the extent of the problem in MSMEs comes to light, particularly for MSMEs, I'm hoping for some more relief. You know, one idea that I've been pushing for here is there's about 20 lakh crores of loans to micro, small and medium enterprises. Maybe we could think of giving them an interest subvention for 6 months. It will not cost much. It will cost about 1.2 lakh crores, which is 0.6% of GDP. It's a big number, but it's not the end of the world. I think some relief to businesses is required. The real fear I have here is it's not just a question of doing the right thing and being good about it. If these companies don't survive, you'll actually have a problem a year later where supply will not be available. When demand comes back, if you don't have industries to provide you with the supplies, you could actually have things like inflation dogging us again. So purely from a survival perspective, I think some of these industries require help. It's difficult, as you said, to give to auto separately, to aviation separately, and stuff like that. Everybody's asking for relief right now. But maybe for micro, small, medium enterprises, something more could be done. That's the short-term part. Medium to long-term part, there is a lot of work to be done. We need to be very clear about where we are, what the objectives are, and a lot of hard work is required in financial institutions, in other sectors, and most importantly, in creating jobs and output. You know, the only way we get out of this mess that we are in right now is in 2-3 years' time, we should have the ability to create jobs and output, which means people like you should be going out, creating industries and creating jobs and output to cater for those, for the consumption. At the moment, we are struggling on those three areas. But if we have a medium-term plan along those lines, I think we could still go on to achieve our immense economic potential.
And Anand, with this, you know, when we're talking about the credit stimulus as well, a lot of MSMEs that I've been talking to, you know, off record, the way it has been is that the ones who already have an existing, you know, facility with the banks or an existing loan with the banks, they are providing them top-ups, okay? Now, for example, an MSME who's never availed any loan from the bank so far in terms of, say, working capital or even an OD facility, nothing has been given to them. Yeah. So what's happening is that the liquidity transmission that's happening from the banks, from the RBI to the banks, but that's not happening from the banks to the ones who actually require this. And slowly, steadily, you are seeing, you know, a death of all of these MSMEs that's really happening. Don't you think that, you know, a step should be taken where a blanket rule needs to be there that, yes, taking into consideration the business prospects, maybe not the credit profile right now because they don't really have a credit profile, but taking the future business prospects, you should do bill discountings for them, or you should, you know, finance the, you know, probably the POs that come in for these MSMEs, and that's the how, that's the way you will be able to revive them.
A great point, Hira. Look, few things we have to keep in mind. Why is it that banks are struggling to lend? You're absolutely right. There is no funding, lack of funding capacity to lend. It's other things. One, they have an overhang of non-performing assets. We cannot wish it away. You know, while we have moratorium, we have forbearance, we are trying to suppress what the real intent of NPAs is. The real NPAs which risk officers and banks can see is far, far higher than what is publicly made available right now, right? If you are a banker and you are looking at an MSME portfolio which is already looking pretty bad in terms of non-performing assets, potentially, even though you're not declaring it as such, would you really be eager to lend out more? Which is why when I mentioned that financial sector cleanup and reforms are required for lending to restart.
Correct.
Absolutely critical. And there is no easy way out of it. You cannot have the government giving out loans and saying, do more mudra. That doesn't help. Eventually, you need the banks to be able to do proper analysis and have the comfort that they will lend. That's the first part. Second part, I think there is a lot that MSMEs need to do themselves to make themselves more creditworthy. You mentioned TREPS, for instance. So I think formalization and ensuring that you, whether it's GST, whether it's all kinds of payments being done on a digital basis rather than on cash basis, you have to make sure that all your books are clean and are available to the banker. Second, invest and make sure you're complying with all laws. Don't play around with GST. Don't play around with taxation. Be honest. It's worth it. Third, have proper governance standards. You know, today bankers have zero trust on anything. It's the job of the people, the borrowers, to instill that trust. You can't have, you know, shady chartered accountants auditing your books, doing all sorts of siphoning of money from your small operations, and then saying the bank is not giving me money. Come with a good auditor, make a clean breast of things, pay the extra price to be in complete compliance. It's worth it. And then go and demand that money from the banker. So both needs to happen. Bankers need to clean up their books and have no problems about, you know, overhang of NPAs and CBI coming and chasing them, etc. Second, even the MSMEs have a lot of work to be done. For every MSME who's good, I can tell you three MSMEs who are doing khapla. That has to stop. You have to move towards better governance and biting the bullet and saying, I will be in the formalized sector. Right? Both have to happen. But the primary problem at the moment is there is a trust deficit and there is unacknowledged problems in the banking books. We have to clean it up before the lending starts again. It's not easy.
Right. So for that, do you think, you know, the recommendation that has, the representation that has gone to the government, to the RBI with regards to where the bad bank is concerned, I think, and this is something which was already put through, I think just when the lockdown had started, formalization on that is important right now?
So absolutely, Hiral. So look, I would start the following way. Think of ourselves as a medical patient. The economy is a medical patient, right? If you go to the doctor and say, I'm sick, the first thing the doctor will say is, let's get tests done and let's look at the medical reports. Mm-hmm. What are the medical reports for the financial sector? It's the NPA number and it's the reality about how your books are looking like. At the moment, we are not looking at the correct medical reports. We are saying, oh, the medical reports are very, very negative. Let's not look at them. We can't handle it. Okay. Now, I see where that is coming from. We are afraid to make things worse at a time when we are already bad. But if you're suffering from blood pressure or cholesterol or high sugar, which are resolvable issues, they are not life-threatening issues, to suppress the medical report is absolutely silly, which is exactly what we are doing. We are starting off by denying the size of the problem. So the first thing I would suggest is, even if you don't tell it to us, at least amongst the RBI and the government, have a sense of what is really happening on bank and NBFC books. That will tell you that if you've got such a high BP and such a high cholesterol, you have no choice but to take drastic action right now. By the way, I'm giving you blood pressure and cholesterol. It could also be tumor. But the tumor is still benign. It's not the end of the world. Every problem is solvable. It is not a life-threatening terminal disease. It is a very, very resolvable problem. So first is accept the problem, get the right medical reports and see what the problem is. If you see the medical reports, for instance, if it shows 18% gross NPAs for banks and NBFCs, I don't think we'll debate at all. Of course, we require something like a bad bank to take out all this NPAs and put it aside and quarantine it. It's like removing a tumor from the system and making sure it doesn't infect the patient. The second thing, Hiral, what is our objective? Is it to keep the patient alive? In which case, that's no problem at all. Our system will not collapse. Anyway, 60% of banks is owned by government. The government will recapitalize. It will not collapse. My mother banks with a public sector bank. She will never bank with a private sector or a foreign bank. Even if that bank is going bust, she will still put her deposit there. So our system will not collapse. But if our objective is system should not collapse, it's a very poor objective. We want the system to be able to lend money. We want 20% credit growth, which means we want the system to run a marathon, not just survive on the bed. For that, you need drastic action. I think bad bank is absolutely required, but it cannot be good money after bad money. It cannot be to just bail out the financiers and the promoters. It has to be followed by very, very tough reforms on banking, on governance, on markets. All of this has to happen together. It's not easy. Politically, it's a nightmare. There will be a lot of debate about this. And I do think surgery is required. It's not enough if you take homeopathy or, you know, drink hot tea. You need far more than that. Start to the right reports, be clear about the objectives, and take the bitter medicine, get the surgery done.
I mean, in absolutely what you're saying makes a lot of sense, that you have to take drastic steps as well, you know, when it reaches that threshold. But with this now, if you have to look at it from RBI's perspective, do you think, number one, that they have been conservative on the fiscal side? Now, do you think they could likely go in for direct monetization? And if that happens, what's the, you know, timeline where they could see direct monetization happening?
Great question, Hiral. So look, on monetization, let's go back one step. There will be a large fiscal deficit. And by the way, like we've not been able to handle the truth and the true medical reports for NPAs, we've not been able to handle the truth on our fiscal numbers as well. Our actual fiscal deficit, both the extent and the quality, is far worse than what the official numbers suggest. Everybody knows this, but we pretend it's all fine. Okay. Having said that, this year, clearly because of COVID-19, the fiscal deficit will be, I mentioned, center plus state will go above 15% of GDP. Now, there is no choice. Monetization will happen. You don't even have to debate it. What I want you to remember is monetization can happen in different forms. It's not necessary that the RBI has to buy government bonds in the primary auction. It's not necessary that the RBI has to print money and give it to the government. What it is doing currently, which is open market operation purchase of bonds in the market, likewise doing TLTROs and doing LTROs, all of this also tantamounts to monetization. So monetization can be done through various routes. I am actually indifferent whether the government does it, whether the RBI does it in primary market or like Indonesia prints money and gives it to the government. No problem. It's all the same according to me. It appears that some people like the rating agencies don't like direct monetization. They prefer it through oblique ways of buying it through bonds, etc. So give them that. Don't do that then. But monetization has to be done. Now, to the last, I guess what your larger point is, do we have room to spend and should the RBI encourage the government to spend more and have a larger fiscal deficit? I'm supposed to be a fiscal hawk. In the previous years, I've been saying government has got too much of fiscal deficit. Even a hawk like me says, please spend. I have no problem if you spend right now in today's context. But you should have a medium-term plan which will lead to jobs and output. Look at it this way, Hiral. What happens when your fiscal deficit goes up very high? Our debt to GDP will become 90% of GDP. Right. We've not seen this number for a long, long time. Okay. Eventually, if you have so much of money being printed and spent by the government, 1 year, 2 years later, you could have one of two things. You could have inflation and you could have very high imports. Because remember, printing money, if the output is not coming from domestically, people will start buying from overseas again. And therefore, we will see our currency weaken. These two things could happen. The only way out of this mess is if you produce jobs and output 2 years down the road. Then what will happen? Despite so much money creating so much demand, we are creating output to fulfill the demand. So our output is going up and therefore inflation doesn't go up. Likewise, when output goes up, GDP goes up, our tax collections go up. When tax collections go up, that's when fiscal deficits come down. In 2000 to 2007, when our fiscal deficit came down, it didn't come down because we cut spending. It came down because our tax collections went up. So to me, no problem on fiscal spending. You spend as much as you want, but it is dependent upon you having a medium-term, reliable, credible framework to create jobs and output. If you don't have that, we have no business spending.
Right. So, Anand, I'm trying to say that with regards to the expense side, on the expenditure side, I mean, there is no real requirement for the government needs to go ahead and curtail with regards to where revival is concerned on the expenditure front?
There are less constraints than we imagine them to be. Okay. Like I said, give relief for the interest subvention on MSMEs. I think there is room for that. I think there is even more room for giving more relief to the bottom of the pyramid, you know, urban unemployment, even more relief to the poor people. I think there's room for all of that. Let me put it this way. You know, as you rightly said, the actual fiscal impact of that Atmanirbhar Bharat package was probably 1 to 1.5% of GDP, not 10% of GDP. I'm saying there's room to go up to 3% of GDP. So a double of what has been provided so far, I think there is room. But again, I have to emphasize, Hiral, this is not in vacuum. We are not saying expend 3%, 4% in a vacuum. You have to spend it knowing that growth will come back, and growth not just in terms of people getting free money, but also in terms of output being created. We have to, so all the ideas that Prime Minister spoke about, get supply chains, get investments in, start to produce, make for India, make in India, both. All of that has to come through, which means if the entire focus should be less upon Excel spreadsheets and trying to balance the fiscal deficit and monetary policy, it has to be about the real economy and how do you create jobs and output. That is the hole that is missing right now.
Right. And very lastly, Anand, with regards to, you know, all the measures that we've been taking, we've seen the RBI also, they have acted really fast with regards to the repo as well as the reverse repo rate cuts. Do you think now there is further room for the RBI to go ahead and cut rates, number one, or is there a need, probably I could put it that way, to reduce rates? And secondly, with all of this, with the liquidity infusion that's happening across economies right now, how do you see the rupee and the bond market functioning?
Great set of questions. And you're right, Hiral, the RBI has done a lot. Frankly, it's done a bulk of the heavy lifting in terms of bringing down, you know, repo rate to 4%. Actual market repo rate is even below that. It's 3%, right? T-bill yields are about 3.5% below the repo rate. Even CD rates have now come below, well below the repo rate. So RBI has done a lot. Does it have room to do more? I think it's done a lot. I'm not sure it should be cutting more rates from here for a couple of reasons. One is transmission is not complete. So even today, the one-year MCLR of SBI is 7%. Right? At a time when the CD rate for SBI is probably 3.5-3.6%. So there's a big, big gap between the market rates and the actual bank lending rates. Now, there are lots of problems for banks, but clearly the transmission of the banking lending rate has to happen better. Second problem is we have a monetary policy framework, which unfortunately is linked to inflation. I think it's a nonsensical framework, but we are where we are. We don't have a choice. Last 6 months, our average inflation, CPI inflation, has been 6.6%. It's higher than the upper threshold of the monetary policy framework, 2 to 6%. At this time, cutting rates can send very mixed signals to the entire marketplace and to external investors. So maybe at this point in time, we should not be cutting rates. When inflation comes down, I think it will come down. At that point of time, we can explore more cutting of rates. Right now, RBI has plenty of tools to keep interest rates under control. One is it can do OMOs, it can do LTROs and TLTROs, it can do FX purchases and, you know, keep liquidity high. So there are plenty of tools, other tools it can use, not necessary that interest rate cuts have to be used. On markets, Hiral, look, it's a tough one, but I'll give you one anyway. The only caveat is, if I'm right, remember me. If I'm wrong, this conversation never happened. So look, I think economists have to stop pretending that we know where markets are headed. Economics is different, markets is different. And likewise, market participants have to stop pretending they know where the economy is going. Just because markets are doing badly or well doesn't mean anything for economics, what's happening on the economy, right? Now, with that in mind, if I look at markets, I have to look at markets standalone. And it has to be based on flows. And flows are looking very comfortable, very paradoxically, very comfortable for most markets. Let's start with currency markets. Currency markets, we are actually having a surfeit of inflows coming in right now. We have a current account surplus for the wrong reasons, because our imports have collapsed, because our consumption has collapsed. So we have a current account surplus. FDI is pouring in. Reliance Jio is raising money every day. It's stopped for the last 1 week, but who knows? Next announcement might come soon. So between FDI and current account surplus, we have tons of money pouring in. RBI is sitting on $517 billion of reserves. It's an all-time record and it's growing. So even though the economy is looking in a terrible shape, for now, the flows are extremely positive. In fact, if RBI was not buying dollars right now, rupee would probably be 72 or 71. You know, it's being held up because of RBI purchases. So here at the short run, in the short run, it looks like rupee will be supported by RBI. RBI will not allow too much of rupee appreciation. By the way, dollar globally has weakened a lot.
Exactly.
It's now below 93, right? So given that, some gentle appreciation of the rupee might happen, but it looks like RBI doesn't want to see the rupee appreciate too much, because the terms of trade will become very, very unfavorable for India if rupee appreciates too much. Our imports will become more, our exports will become challenged. So it looks like RBI is holding that line there. 1 year down the road, Hiral, I'm worried about the rupee. And the reason being that right now, this current account surplus is an aberration. Once our consumption comes back, a lot of our consumption, unfortunately, is imported. And it's not just energy and gold. It's also plastics. It's also chemicals. It's also fertilizers. It's almost every material that we produce, intermediaries are imported. So given that, once that consumption starts, imports will go up. And therefore, our current account deficit will start again. And by the way, our economy is not looking good. So the combination of that 1 year down the road, I am worried about the rupee. Right now, I'm not, because the flows are very, very comfortable. On bond markets, likewise, a couple of things have happened. One is there is no lending happening by banks on the credit side, right? Therefore, banks have capacity to lend to the government. And right now, they're buying bonds. Plus, RBI is also supporting the markets. You know that Governor Das is essentially saying, "Main hoon na, kya tension." So essentially, therefore, that the market is taking a lot of comfort that RBI will protect the bond markets with rate cuts, with LTROs, OMOs, whatever is required, right? So therefore, there is a lot of support for bond markets as well right now. Okay, but like in the case of currency markets, I'm worried about what will happen 1 year down the road for a couple of reasons. One is so much of money is being printed, Hiral. You know, our M3 growth is at 12-13% at a time when our economy is contracting. Right. So there is a lot of money in the system. Eventually, when consumption starts, inflation looks almost inevitable. And likewise, the currency problem also looks inevitable. So 1 year down the road, can we say that inflation will not come up? I cannot say that. It feels like inflation can come up down the road. So therefore, very similar to the currency markets, I'm okay with bond markets for now. In fact, I'm personally long some mutual funds on debt market, debt funds, for 3 year, 2 year kind of duration. But I'm really worried about what could happen 1 year down the road. Last bit on equity markets, that's a complete, I don't understand equity markets at all, but I'll give Gyan anyway. Again, the flows are looking good in terms of actual retail flows going in.
Correct.
Right? So even though mutual funds are showing lower inflows, they're not showing outflows, right? They're still showing net inflows. Right. And all of us sitting at home doing nothing seem to be trading on Zerodha.
Digital usage in terms of trading has gone up tremendously right now.
Exactly right. So retail, look at it this way, Hiral. Fact is, on a tax-adjusted basis, people like you and me have very little options besides gold maybe and now equities. And therefore, equity at a time when interest rates are as low as it is and the tax is unfavorable, we will invest in equities, even if you're losing money in equities. So that flow is absolutely continuing. And by the way, this is not a recent phenomenon. You know, December 13 to December 19, your earnings growth for Nifty 50 was just 4.1% per annum. Your Nifty itself went up by 11.6% per annum, right? So that wedge between performance and markets has been going on forever. And this can continue, the circus can continue for a longer time. I don't know when the equity markets, if at all they'll converge, when they'll converge. I have no idea. So equity and bond markets, I'm comfortable right now, but I'm not comfortable 1 year down the road.
I'm going to interrupt here. You know, right now what's happening is the fundamentals are not matching what's happening in the markets. You know, as you exactly mentioned, that the economy is in the worst shape ever. There are no fundamentals with regards to where businesses are concerned. I mean, your earnings are not really matching. In fact, if you talk about the tech stocks as well, especially in terms of the FANG or the US tech bubble. Now, the valuation is way higher if you compare, you know, what the valuations were during the dot-com bubble as well, back then in, you know, probably 1997. So, when you have to compare all of this, my sense is that the markets across, maybe currencies, bonds or equity, are really waiting for that one event to happen where you will see a boom, a crash that comes in. Do you think it's a very hypothetical situation where I think no one has to catch you and me for it, but do you think elections in the US, probably October, November, December, that's probably the crucial period that we need to watch out for, where it has a major impact on all of these markets, because fundamentally we know what's happening. On the economic front, you know, on the economy front, we know what's happening.
So Hiral, the honest answer is I have no idea. But I'll give you a guess anyway. I don't think elections will stop this circus. Okay, look, we talked about this being flow driven. The markets are flow driven.
Correct.
About M3 going up by 12-13%. All that money is in deposits in our accounts, right? And it's not being spent. So that money has to be invested somewhere, and the money is going to asset markets. It's going to gold. It's going to equity markets in India. It's not going to real estate as yet, but you know the other markets it is going to. I think even if you don't see consumer price inflation globally because of other reasons, asset price inflation looks here to stay simply given the huge amount of money which is being printed. Where will that money go? I think the time when you could actually see asset price actually maybe correct to some extent is paradoxically if the economy was to recover. If you actually had inflation coming back and therefore central banks started withdrawing that liquidity, then there would be less liquidity to chase up assets. And that's when you could actually see a contraction. But look, the way I'm playing this, Hiral, first of all, I'm going to experts like yourself to ask, what should I do with my portfolio? Please help me do my asset allocation. Second, I think timing events is next to impossible. If you're looking for the top, if you're looking for the bottom, you're in the wrong
place. You're not going to find, absolutely.
The only thing you can do is try and have a diversified portfolio. Have something in gold, have something in real estate, have something in equities, have something in fixed income, have something in currencies, and try and diversify it. If you have the ideal portfolio is through beginning of January to today, you had to do nothing. You are happy with the overall diversified portfolio. Now, I think that's impossible, but that's the ideal that you should be pushing for. Trying to time, at least for people like me who are kind of risk averse.
For anyone, absolutely. Right. And very lastly, Anand, you know, the other question I want to ask is infrastructure as well as on the construction side, all of them are dependent on NBFCs for financing. And the NBFCs are interdependent again on the banks, as we know. What happens to that side of the business? Because again, the transmission on that front is also not happening yet when we talk to NBFCs.
So I'm going to make a very general comment because it's unfair and because NBFCs are not a homogeneous entity, you know, set of people. You have extremely good entities, you have some not that good, right?
Absolutely.
But across the NBFC, HFC, MFI, all of them, right? There is a problem. If the problem is of non-performing assets is acute in banks, it's even more acute in NBFCs, where the level of denial is even higher.
Okay.
So you know, if you were to do an asset quality review for NBFCs today, we will all have a collective heart attack. You're waiting for that. Okay. So the problem is therefore that as a class, the capacity for NBFCs to actually lend out money right now is very, very low. Now, again, this is not the end of the world. Okay, this is part of a process. No country becomes great, you know, overnight. It happens over a period of time. It goes back to my point that the financial services ecosystem requires a team. It's not easy. It is a tumor which has to be removed. There's a lot of bitter medicine to be taken. That has to happen holistically. You cannot play around this in bits and pieces and say something will happen. You know, I hear some people saying, oh, it's okay. You know what? Loan growth will start again in a year's time. Then all sare pub bhul jayenge. Nahi hoga. If you're sitting on so much of loan losses, you'll not be able to lend. People don't trust you enough to give you money in the first place. You know, who are you kidding? Your NPA numbers might show extremely low numbers, but the market is not giving you money. Why? Because nobody trusts you. So the short answer, therefore, is not just NBFCs, the entire financial services ecosystem to be in a position to lend credit growth 20% again. You cannot do it with status quo or with small tinkering. It requires big changes. And the earlier we recognize that, earlier we see the real medical reports and see what the problem is, the better for us.
Right. Absolutely. And I think, you know, for India as a country as well, and the majority of the reforms have come in times of crisis. So probably we need to take this as an opportunity right now, make our reforms strong to start moving ahead. To see that growth is back from here on. Thank you so much for joining us on the show. It was a pleasure having you. Great insights that we picked up. I hope you enjoyed the conversation as well, and we will see you soon.
Always a pleasure, Hiral. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.